Good morning, everyone. Everyone here and those watching this week, I just love how the Holy Spirit takes God's word and takes the service and he multiplies it and sends it forth. So praise God for that. And Pastor Ken and Joe, we're glad we're here. One of you this morning said, it's just good to be alive. Amen. I know. So we thank God for that. Hard to believe it's the first Sunday in Advent. We light the candle of hope today, all about hope. I have a lot of little sayings about hope and a lot of scripture about hope, and kind of let it sink down inside of us. Next Sunday, Pastor Jared will do the second candle on peace, and we'll be back all the way through January 14th. We'll be here for Christmas Eve Day, the fourth candle of love, and then the next Sunday, Joni has a great New Year's service, and then we begin the 12 days of Christmas right after Christmas Day, right? All the way to Epiphany, and we'll celebrate that January 7th. And then a week later, we'll have Jesus' baptism as he begins his public ministry, and as we have some Christians here that will be baptized as well. And I said this before, if you know someone who isn't baptized, who'd like to be baptized, that Sunday, January 14th, they could be baptized here. Just talk to me afterwards or give me a name or something else. And who knows how the Holy Spirit can work, right? Praise God. So as we gather, I love this candle being lit here, and we continue. The dictionary defines the word Advent as the arrival of a notable person, thing, or event. What a perfect description, as today we enter the Advent season, prepare our hearts for Christ's birth. Advent helps us focus on what is most important and what heals us, like hope, peace, joy, and love. Our four Advent candles, with the light of Christ being at the center of it all, let us make room in our hearts for him this transformative Advent season, as we wait for a reason for this season. And I was going to mention, too, the Lord taught me a little lesson with my guitar. It's kind of bad news, good news. The bad news is that I don't have my guitar today. The good news is it's being repaired, and I'll have it next, 2 weeks from today when we're back. And then I asked the guy fixing it, and he said, I'm going to fix it so it's just like new again. And amen. And he said, it won't be exactly like new. It'll be new but different. And I thought, isn't that just like Christ? You know, he puts us back together, we break things, we crack things, and we're back together new, but we're different in Christ as well. So while we are waiting today, Christ comes to us this service. Of hope, peace, joy, and love, remembering the promises of God. We wait in hope for the Lord. He is our help and our shield. Let us pray together. O Lord, our Advent King, you chose not to remain equal with God, but left the glories of heaven to become flesh like us, so that you might redeem us. You came into our darkness and gave us your light of hope. We come waiting upon you, our triune God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. So we sing this special song to the favorite tune of Blessed Assurance. Or for viewing this service at home and just letting the waters, our baptismal grace, wash over us again and to be cleansed. So we continue based on Isaiah 63. O Lord, you are our Father, our Redeemer from his old. No one has heard, no ear has perceived, no eye has seen any God besides you. But we have sinned against your ways. How then can we be saved? All of us have become like one who is unclean, and all our righteous acts are like filthy rags. Yes, O Lord, you are our Father. We are the clay, you are the potter. We are the work of your hand. So that we, repenting of our sins and confessing our wretchedness, may obtain from you, the God of all mercy, perfect forgiveness and life everlasting, through our Lord and Savior Jesus. Amen. Amen. God hears our cries for mercy, and for his Son's sake, he comes down to us, not in judgment, but in forgiveness. A gift to us from Christ himself. Therefore, in the stead and by the command of my Lord Jesus Christ, I announce to you that all your sins are forgiven, In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Inspired, God breathed. The word inspiration means God breathed, right? God breathed into the writers. Romans 5. Therefore, since we have been justified through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have gained access by faith into this grace in which we now stand. And we boast in the hope of the glory of God. Not only so, but we also glory in our sufferings, because we know that suffering produces perseverance, perseverance character, and character hope. And hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured out into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. Our first reading. And then the famous Isaiah 40 on eagle's wings as we sing today. Do you not know? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He will not grow tired, and his understanding no one can fathom. He gives strength to the weary and increases the power of the weak. Even youths grow tired and weary, and young men stumble and fall. But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint.
Thank you.
Lord, thank you so much. It's a brand new day in every way. Your mercies are new every morning. We go to bed at night, it's like a death. We wake up, it's resurrection. And Lord, you're here today in a special way. Your word is alive, it's sharper than a two-edged sword. It pierces through the very divisions of bone and marrow to soul and spirit. So Lord, let these words be your words. And as we listen, Lord, let our thoughts be your thoughts, your spirit's thought in us on this first Sunday in Advent. In Jesus' name, amen. I remember one of my earliest memories, and I asked a number of you when you came in today, do you remember the Advent calendars? And I remember, I think it must have been given out by our churches, because there's a lot of secular ones, there's a lot out there, but still today. But I always remember, you wake up the next day, and you push back that little window counting down to Christmas, and there'd be a scripture verse there, there'd be something else also. So it's really exciting, actually. It was a great way to get ready, wasn't it, to prepare our hearts for Christ's birth. So we have the candles. The candles can be different names, like the candle of hope today is also the prophet's candle. You know, there's a Bethlehem candle, there's a shepherd's candle, right, over the years. But these are the main ones, hope, peace, joy, and love. And in the middle of it, right, is Jesus in the middle. On Christmas Day, we'll put a large white candle in the center as well of the Advent wreath. And I kind of like this. As I said during my sermon today, we'll be looking at the two lessons in a little bit, but we'll kind of be working up to those with some special sayings about Advent, with some special scriptures about Advent. Jesus is right in the middle, for unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given. We already used the Isaiah 60 for confession today. We already sang Isaiah 40, right, from eagle's wings. And so here's Isaiah. Remember Isaiah 7 says, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and you shall call his name Emmanuel. And then Isaiah 9, for unto us a child is born, son is given, and the government, remember, shall be upon his shoulders. He shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Prince of Peace. We're talking the Old Testament, 700 years before Jesus was born. Isaiah, oh my gosh, Isaiah is like a Bible in one book. In fact, there's 66 chapters in Isaiah, 66 books in the Bible. You know, Isaiah is a spirit-filled, unbelievable gospel. I mean, Old Testament book, as you know. So we have hope. People are in darkness. Think about that. People are in darkness. They not only see light, but they see a great light because of Christ, as the Magi illustrate, right? You know, peace, he shall be our peace. Do not be afraid. Joy, pink candle, gaudete. Remember, the angel said this. Who did the angel say this to? Do not be afraid, I am bringing you good news of great joy for all people. The shepherds, exactly. Out in the fields, the stinking shepherds, literally. God bless them, you know. They're creating these lambs, and Bethlehem is only 5 miles south of Jerusalem. And they're creating, they're giving birth to these, you know, caring for the sheep and the lambs, the spotless white lambs that they sacrificed in the temple. And as many of you know, because they were considered unclean, because they lived out with the animals, they couldn't even go to the temple. They weren't even welcome in the temple, but they're welcome by Jesus Sunday. The first people come to announce that. Isn't that amazing? Well, after Mary, of course, Mary and Elizabeth, and, you know. And then love, keep yourselves in the love of God and wait and await the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ. So the hope candle, also known as the prophet's candle, this first candle of Advent signifies the promise of Messiah. Think about it. The people who walk in darkness have seen a great light, and then it says, upon those who dwell in the land of gloom, a light has shone. Don't you love that? The ones who live in the land of gloom, a light has come. They've come not just for the Jews, but all over the world. Praise God. I just love that. You know, we're spoiled because it has already happened. We look back, right? 2,000 years. He hadn't come yet. You know, they're waiting since Abraham. It's been 2,000 years since Abraham, and much longer before that. So they believe by faith. Abraham believed, and it was counted to him as righteousness, right? Before Abraham was, Jesus said, I am. Praise God. So we have this candle of hope. I love this. What is hope? It's faith holding out its hand in the dark. Isn't that good? That's what hope is. It's holding on. And if you take all the great words in the scriptures that talk about God, you put them all together, and you have hope. Isn't that beautiful? So the great big words here, probably most often, top row, faith, Jesus, grace, freedom. You have Messiah right in the middle there. Then on the bottom, you have King and peace and Jehovah and light and Savior. And it goes on and on. Isn't that great? It's like a secret code in the Bible. And we've deciphered it by the Spirit. And there it is, shining. And it's almost like a little town of Bethlehem beneath there. Cast out our sin and enter in. Be born in us today, right? Tonight, O little town of Bethlehem. So hope. Romans 15 gives a couple scripture verses. He will rule over the Gentiles. They will place their hope on him. Love that. And this one from the Old Testament Lamentations. This I recall to my mind, therefore have I hope. It is of the Lord's mercies that we are not consumed. Oh, isn't that heavy? You know, Moses, you can't see me, God said to Moses, but I'll hide you in a rock and I'll pass by. Right? So God passes by, and rock of ages cleft for me, simply hide myself in thee. And so Moses is hid in the crack. And God passes by. And when Moses comes down, his face is just shining, right? As we just sang, I love that. You know, he makes us to shine like the sun, which we're promised in heaven we will shine like Christ will shine. His compassions fail not. They are new every morning. Great is thy faithfulness. You know the song? We could sing that chorus with me. Great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. Morning to morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hands have provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Hebrews 10. Let us hold unswervingly to the hope we profess, for he who promised is faithful. And so, it's like this prayer, fill us with hope. We pray that. And once God keeps answering that prayer, we have this Advent living hope every single day, which I just love. And then we make room in our hearts. The reason we celebrate Advent, and it might be new for some of you growing up, maybe you didn't light candles. Not that you weren't Christian, not that you didn't go to church. You know, it's not just a Catholic thing or a Methodist thing or whatever. In fact, we were just talking with Ruth. What was it? St. Francis lived about 1200. And so, you know, you think of 1200 to now, 1700 years. St. Francis of Assisi was the first one to have a living nativity scene of people in the village. Isn't that beautiful? Yeah, I love that. And so we spend every Sunday getting ready to make more room in our heart than we have in the past for Christ by his work. And so it can be a struggle. We work and we struggle for this. Our hope is set on the living God, who is the Savior of all people, especially those who believe. And sometimes you feel you might not have much hope, but that's okay, because Jesus gives new hope, right? And then I love this. Hope is the only thing stronger than fear. And when we say hope, we don't just say, oh gosh, I hope I make it to heaven. We say, no, we have a living hope that helps us know. In fact, don't take my word for it, ever. If I can't share it in scriptures, we're going to start with, and I'll share a few verses about our trials and tribulations. I took this from our earlier today. In the third sentence down, what does it say? Even youths grow tired and weary. Young men stumble and fall. But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint. Many of you may know that this coming summer, actually about almost exactly 8 months from this weekend, begins the 2024 Olympics in Paris, France. And maybe you know this, I bet some of you do, exactly 100 years ago, Paris, 1924, Paris had the Olympics. And there's so many great athletes, it was beautiful. And so it's the centennial in the same place, and one of the greatest athletes at the Games was Eric Liddell. If some of you have seen the movie Chariots of Fire, yes, it was the Oscar nominated for four Academy Awards in 1981. And of the four, they won four Oscars, and one of them was for Best Picture. And I'm sure they'll be showing this leading up to the Olympics, so it'll be over the television. And Eric Liddell is this incredible runner, but he's also a missionary. He was born in China, and when he was five, his dad was a pastor in China. His parents were missionaries in China. When he was 5 years old, he came back to London, Edinburgh, Scotland, and also went to school with his brother, boarding school in London. And he created so many records. He felt when he ran God's pleasure. And so he used God's pleasure when he ran to witness for his faith, as many athletes do today. And some of you may remember from the movie, his greatest race was the 100-yard dash and the 200, but his greatest was the 100-yard. And he found out that it was the heats to run that race to qualify were on Sunday. And he just couldn't run on the Lord's Day. And you might say, well, my gosh, it's the Olympics. And maybe some of us would have peace about that and still run, but he would not run, true story. And so he went to church on that day. And so this is just a 2-minute video clip as he's in church, not running that day. And he's kind of contrasting Isaiah with his poor running mates that day who were stumbling badly and falling. So we'll play this. So there's a picture. I don't know how Herb Brooks got in there. He's the miracle on ice, maybe because we're in Minnesota, but You can see the rest of the pictures. There's from the movie and also Eric Little, some actual pictures from him. The reason I mention that also is because he was a great missionary. And after the Olympics, he went back to China. He was a missionary for 20 years there. People who met him say they've never met anyone like him. He came as close to being a saint as they've ever met anyone. And so he was in, when the Japanese started to invade China in World War II, they became very aggressive. And he was placed in an internment camp by the Japanese. And he died there. And he 5 months before the camp was liberated, he died. But he was there for 20 years, like I said, with his sister Jenny and his brother was a doctor, were there as well. So just a great witness to God's faith and God's grace as well. So once you fall down like that, poor guys, there's a great prayer. Father, when I'm tired, you give me the strength to go on. And when discouraged, you give me hope. And when I'm afraid, you are my peace. Thank you. And so the last few slides here, I want to look at a couple of reasons, a couple of scriptures that we had today. This is so powerful. If you wonder why you suffer sometimes, you know, the wrong question to ask God is why, because he'll never get an answer to that. Exactly. Ours is not to reason why, but for us to do or die. But, like my guitar, God works through it, doesn't he? What does it say here? We also glory in our tribulations, trials and tribulations, knowing that tribulation produces perseverance, perseverance character, and character hope. And I love this. Hope does not disappoint us. Why? Because the love of God has been poured out into our hearts by the Holy Spirit who's been given to us. So we don't always know the answers, but we know how God works miraculously. Perseverance, character, hope, poured out by the Holy Spirit in our hearts with God's love. I was thinking about this, Jesus, and about five things to put your hope in Christ. If you put your hope in Jesus. And I just wanted to, I want to do a scripture for each one of those. And if you, again, like I said, don't take my word for it. You know, let the scriptures speak to us. It says faith comes by hearing and hearing by God's word, right? And so here's five reasons to put your hope. That top left one might be a little bit hard to read, but it says joy in Jesus. J-O-Y stands for Jesus, others, and yourself, right? J-O-Y. And so we start with joy. We rejoice in Jesus. So if you'd like to read with me or just follow along these five scriptures. In this you greatly rejoice, though now for a little while, if need be, you have been grieved by various trials. That the genuineness of your faith, being much more precious than gold that perishes, though it is tested by fire, may be found to praise, honor, and glory at the revelation of Jesus Christ. So we just talked about tribulations, right? In Romans 5, 1-5. And now we have 1 Peter 1. We have various trials that test our faith to come forth like gold. So joy in Jesus, praise in Jesus. I love this next verse. By him, therefore, let us offer the sacrifice of praise to God continually. That is the fruit of our lips, giving thanks to his name. So what should we do to God? What should we give God? Well, we give God the sacrifice of our praise, don't we? How does that one song go about? He, as we praise God, he, Andre Crouch, remember that song? The chains fall off of us as we praise God as well. Thirdly, the Jesus of mercy. Mercy of Jesus right there. A great verse from Hebrews chapter 4. Let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. Whatever we need is there for us, which is usually always, right? People say that God is just a crutch for those who are weak, and we say, no, he's not a crutch. He's our total life support system, right? I love that phrase. And then we have a living hope in Jesus. Here's a great verse from Proverbs. We don't quote Proverbs too much. It talks a lot about honey in Proverbs. Know also that wisdom is like honey for you. If you find it, there is a future hope for you, and your hope will not be cut off. And then lastly, a hope of eternal life. We don't just hope about eternal life, we thank God for our living hope we have. This is such a great verse. What should we do the work of God? Someone asked Jesus that in John chapter 17. And what did Jesus say? It's so simple. He said this. This is life eternal, that they might know thee, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom thou hast sent. What does it mean to have eternal life? It means to know Christ, right? It begins now, as we know, and it goes on forever. And again, probably my very favorite verse in the whole Bible is the last one I shared. It's John 5:24. And the reason this is probably my favorite is because there's four amazing truths in this one verse. If you read it in the King James, Jesus says, verily, verily, I say. Some NIV says, truly, truly, I say unto you, right? This is the New King James Version. Whenever Jesus says, verily, verily, it means this is super important. Don't miss this, right? Most assuredly, I say to you, he who hears my word and believes in him who sent me has eternal life and shall not come into judgment, but has passed from death into the light. Here's the four things. Faith comes by hearing, right? So when we hear God's word, we hear his word, and then we believe. The word causes faith and hope, right? Secondly, we have eternal life. We already have it, number two, right? We've said that a lot, but it's so true. People forget about that, and they think, oh, I hope I make it to heaven. Well, if you confess Jesus Christ as Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, we will be saved, which begins now. Thirdly, this is really big, you will not come into judgment. I know the Bible says that everyone needs to stand before the judgment seat of God and receive in his person everything that's done, may it good or evil. It does say that. But it also says the judgment of God for us is welcome into my heaven. Come ye, blessed of my Father, inherit eternal life, for I was hungry. You fed me, I was naked, you clothed me, I was in prison and sick, you visited me, you helped me. Enter into your rest. That's our judgment. It's crowns of glory, as God talks about in Revelation. We receive the blessing. Everything else in our life will just be burned up. But what's done for Christ? How's that phrase go? One short life will soon be passed, whatever is done for Christ will last. Right? And then lastly, so you won't come into judgment, as you might think judgment, but you've already passed from death to life. Isn't that great? We've already passed from death to life. So as we've often said, our last breath on earth is what? Our first breath in heaven. Amen? Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Let's pray. Lord, thank you so much for your word that works faith in our heart. Thank you for taking the words today through pictures, through video, through favorite sayings, whatever they are, Lord. Thank you for giving us new hope, a living hope, Lord, for praise and joy and mercy and everything else. And Lord, we don't understand why people suffer. We don't understand what's happening exactly in Israel and Gaza and Russia and Ukraine, Lord, but you know. And so, Lord, through our prayers, through our billions of dollars that are giving for humanitarian aid and everything else, for the missionaries over there, for the Jews, for the Arab Christians, and for Muslims and others who actually are working together. Maybe, Lord, they're working together in a way they've never, ever worked together before. So let them be a light and a witness to the world, Lord, and use this time, as you promised, to work everything for the good, for those who know you, Lord. Help more people know you through this tragedy, even though 15,000 people already died, and 1,200 in Israel, and 15,000, Lord, in Gaza. So bless them and keep them, Lord, and lighten their loads and their spirit. And we pray for all the hostages that more are reading. Lord, for any other prayers for birthdays, we pray for Carol's son, Philip. His birthday is tomorrow, or firstborn grandchild, our daughter, granddaughter Nora's birthday this week. There's probably lots of birthdays out here. So we just give them to you for another year of life. And Lord, we pray it's a new life in Christ as well, because that's your will. As we pray everything according to your will, in the prayer you've taught us to pray together, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. The Holy Spirit is often referred to as the oil of gladness, right? And so we come today, we light our candle, and we take the candle with us, don't we? Like the living bread, like the living water. And we share it with people, our friends who are in darkness, our friends who are thirsty, our friends who are hungry. We have that, and God has given it to us to share that. So thank you, keeping the candle lit as we sing our closing song. Thank you.